Him, please.
Oh, stop. Who's your favorite Darren on Bewitched? The first one or the second one? Like York or Sergeant?
Told you I hate television.
I like your new pin guy.
Thank you. Stick 'em.
No, man. We say, it's like a drum thing. We say, blick 'em. Or however you want to say it. Stick 'em is cool. You probably need this job like you need a hole in the head.
People who think there should be a 7-day waiting period for point and shoot cameras. I don't even know what that means. That's what they think, yes. Hello. Yeah. Is that Bob Marley? I can't see. Huh? Okay. Yes. When I wear glasses, my vision gets worse. Yes. Oh, boy. Welcome to the Arsenio Hall Show. I am him or I am he. If you're into English. Hi, everybody. Yeah. Madonna's new book is coming out. It's called Sex. It'll be available in stores October 21st. Among other things, it will feature tattooed, bare-breasted lesbian skinheads posing with Madonna. That's the truth. Oh, yeah. Oh, that's wonderful. Yes. They say there's a really shocking photo in the book. They've been trying to keep under wraps, and they say it's a photo like you've never seen Madonna before. Apparently, she has clothes on. And, yeah, I can't wait to see that. Ooh, that's nasty. Give you an idea how sexually explicit the photos in the book are. Critics are already comparing them to those vacation snapshots of Fergie. Yeah, that's, ooh, wow. Yeah. Big royal family fan over here. Do you know Fergie?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Look who said it, stand up. Yeah. You know Fergie. Yeah, right. Anything to get on TV. You know? You ain't slick. I know Fergie. Hi, Mom. Oh, here's something else you'll be interested in, sir. The filming of Lethal Weapon 4 began today. Check out your monitors. They couldn't get Danny Glover in. Yeah. You like the Lethal Weapon movies?
Very nice.
Yeah. It'll still be an action movie with those guys. Of course, if you're a Republican, it'll be a horror film, so brace yourself. What do you do, sir? Very articulate, very dapper young man. What do you do?
I'm an actor.
You an actor?
Yes.
Yeah, sure. I'm just kidding.
East 55th and Woodland.
That's Cleveland.
I know.
You from Cleveland?
Yeah.
Homie. here to become an actor?
Yeah.
Have you done some things yet?
I've done some commercials and movies.
Oh, yeah. And what's your name?
James. James Black.
Pleasure to meet you. James Black.
Yeah.
So they'll know you a brother.
You know!
Yeah. Right on. Yeah. Wait, there might be some agents or something. Do you have an agent yet?
William Carroll Agency, yeah.
Oh. Are you working a little bit?
Yeah.
Oh, let's do a scene together. Improv. Mama, I lost the money. Now, you be Mama. let's see, what else is going on? In the first published interview since being sworn into the Supreme Court, Clarence Thomas said that the biggest change in his life has been the total loss of anonymity. I kind of feel sorry for him, you know? Think about it, wherever this guy goes, people are probably screaming at him, hey, Long Dong! You know, it's probably a hell for, you know? Lift your robe, let me see your gavel! Ah! All that kind of stuff, you know?
Hey, George Thomas, can I borrow your razor? My Coke can needs a shave.
You know, it's probably hell. Boy, oh, thank you for reading. Thank you. speak into the machine, please. The mother of, that was just for Robert Klein. He's someplace there. mother of Jennifer Fitzgerald. You know who she is? You know who Jennifer Fitzgerald is? Okay, Jennifer Fitzgerald is the woman who allegedly had an affair with George Bush. Okay, her mother says that her daughter is disappointed in the way Bush handled the story and everything when it came out and hit the papers. Bush's babe is disappointed. You hear that? Bush's babe is disappointed in him. Join the club! We're all disappointed! She's disappointed. I'm disappointed and I didn't even get to go to Switzerland. in a speech in front of the Economic Club of Detroit. You all from the Motor City? At first I thought you all were correcting my pronunciation because I said Detroit, y'all said Detroit. That's how I know y'all from there. Detroit. Yes. It's not Detroit when you're from there. It's Detroit. Yes. Yeah, he was there. And President Bush outlined his economic plans for America. These plans include cutting pay of most of the federal employees, except himself, of course, and giving the middle class a tax break that works out, now get this, it works out to about $5 a week. $5 a week. Actually, that might help, though. $5 a week can get yourself a piece of cardboard and buy a magic marker and write one of those "We'll work for food" signs. $5 a week. What is that? Here's a word of advice for me. If you get your $5 a week, don't put it in the bank. You wouldn't want Neil Bush to steal it. $5 a week. What's $5 a week? Boy. $5? Come on. You know what the economy is like. The deficit is higher than Bill Clinton in an Oxford dorm room. We need more than $5 a week. Give me a break. Thank you, sir. The actor sitting over there saying, okay, I get that joke. Yeah. The plan is supposed to double the nation's output in the next 10 years. Boy, a week ago he thought he was Harry Truman. Now he thinks he's Harry Houdini. George. Also yesterday, now this is interesting, President Bush accidentally referred to Al Gore as Vice President Gore by mistake. Did you read that? Yes. By mistake, wow. President Bush said Vice President Gore. These might be the most damaging words an individual has spoken to end a career since we heard, hey, get me a roll of film for the camera, Sun Yi. Yeah, I think those are, oh, thank you. The awareness kind of rose up through the audience. You know, Sun Yi. Oh, that wood is warming. Oh, well, we got a great show. Give me something. What?
No, no, I was just saying, he got it.
Yeah.
He was totally into it.
Yeah. Detroit. Now, give me something mellow, man. It's Friday. I'm ready for the weekend. Go back to your roots. Go back to your roots, okay, man. Yeah, yeah. Why you put this down?
Okay. One, two.
Is that him? Are you sure? Michael Wolfe. The lady has a new series and she's back to tell us about it. Marky Post is here. Yes. Motown began in Detroit a long time ago. And these gentlemen are keeping Motown alive. The soulful sounds of Boys to Men in the house. From the number one movie in the country, the star of the number one movie in the country, Honeymoon in Vegas. Your favorite and mine, Nicolas Cage. Are we ready? I'll take one of those too. Let's get busy. Go! Join me on next week. I'll have a lot of people here. Angela Lansbury will be back. Martin Lawrence will be here from the new show Martin. Yes. Randy Travis will be here. Randall Cunningham. Yes, Randy. Yes. the queen of the Thighmasters, Suzanne Summers, will be in the house.
Hello, Suzanne. How are you? Good to see you. Come on, come on.
Quincy Jones, Tim Allen, Susie. Yes. That's Quincy and Tim. We love them together. Quincy and Tim will be singing, so that's going to be wonderful. Susan Day, Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch, Sheila Kelly, Brandon Fraser, Julie Brown, White Julie Brown, Soup Dragons will be here. Patti LaBelle has a new television series. She'll be here. A lot of people will be here. So all of you come back, and sir, you can come back, because you're from Cleveland, and act like you're going to get in. He's an actor. You all know my first guest from offbeat roles in movies like Peggy Sue Got Married, Moonstruck, Wild at Heart. Please welcome Nicolas Cage. Have you all seen the movie, or you just think he's cute?
Wait, what's up?
Seen that? It's kind of split. The guy here thinks you're cute, though.
Hey.
I went to check out the screening or the premiere.
That's right, you were there.
Yeah. Now, how did that feel? Because, you know, usually at premieres, there's not a lot of laughter because industry people, you know, they have to keep up that air of like, well, it's not that funny and sure. I'm in the business. You know, how did that feel? They were going crazy.
It felt great. It felt just great. I mean, you know, yeah, I'd played these serious, dramatic characters, and this was like one of the few comedies that I had done. When I heard the people laughing like that, it just was terrific. It was a terrific feeling. So I want to make more comedies. I want to do that.
Now, is that hard for you to accomplish? Are there people in this town who think you can only play the weird, offbeat guys?
Well, you know, it's true that I did screen test for the part because there really wasn't anything in the work that I'd done before that would suggest I could do it. I mean, I had a wooden hand in Moonstruck, and I wore a snakeskin jacket in Wild at Heart. So, but I just really connected with this script. Mm. And I walked in, I said to Andy Bergman, I think we're going to make history together. We're going to make history together. We got to do this.
Yeah. You were funny in Raising Arizona.
Yeah, but I was still sort of this offbeat character. I was, I stole a baby in the movie, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. In this movie, I mean, you make stuff that's not funny on paper funny. You know, I mean, when you, the line, he lives in a shack!
Right.
It's a funny line. You all have to go see this movie. Very funny. Let's see. First of all, tell them what it's about.
Well, I have this problem with commitment. I have a fear of commitment because my mother, played beautifully by Anne Bancroft, just says, you can never get married because no woman will love you the way I do. And then she dies on me, so I've got this incredible fear of commitment. Finally, you know, I've got this great girl friend played by Sarah Jessica Parker, and finally she says, you know, if you're not gonna get married, I'm leaving. And well, I say, let's go and do it. I go to Las Vegas and I meet Tommy Corman, played by James Caan, who's this really slick gambler. He sees her and he feels like she's a dead ringer for my deceased wife, and I have to have her. So I lose her in a card game and have to spend the rest of the movie trying to win her back. It's a total nightmare, actually.
Yeah.
It's a study in frustration is what it is.
Why do you think people are taking to the movie so well?
I think because the movie's really about people, and the characters are ordinary people that you can relate to and identify with. In fact, there's a line in the movie where I say, I'm every man. And the character really is like every man. He gets into situations at an airport, that, you know, with Ben Stein at the front of the line, trying to get that ticket to get on the plane to get his fiance back. And I think everybody's been waiting online like that so they can relate to it.
It's a great scene. And Ben is very good.
He's great. He
nice
is terrific.
Man. We'll look at the clip. You want to set this up for them?
Yeah, my fiance is going to leave to Hawaii to be with Tommy Corman, and I'm basically having a slight nervous breakdown, so this is what's happening here.
Number one movie in the country, Sandy, roll it.
Only for a few days.
Come on, you're so, like, blithe about this all of a sudden, like, you don't give a damn!
Of course I give a damn, but this was not my idea, okay, Jack? Poker was not my idea.
Would you please stop crucifying me with this?
My bag.
He's gonna jump all over you the second he gets there.
Oh, then I'll let him, please. Jack, give me a little credit.
He'll overcome you. I mean, what happens if you start screaming? It's like a jungle over there! He probably has servants and bodyguards, and believe me, they will drug you!
His son is gonna be there, Jack. His granddaughter, Tiffany, will be there.
She knows the kid's name already. Okay. Marry me tonight.
No!
No, why not?
Because I don't believe you. I mean, Jack, if you really wanted to marry me, you would have done it this afternoon. Yes, this is the Alibaba suite. I have some bags that have to be brought down.
We'll be right back. Nicolas Cage. I always wanted to ask you why you didn't use Nicholas Coppola.
Well, I used to read comic books. I really like comic books. And there was this character named Luke Cage, Power Man. When I was a child, I would read this. And I thought he was kind of a cool superhero. Mm-hmm. And then I went to school, and I studied music for a while, and I heard about John Cage, who was this experimental composer. So I went Luke Cage, John Cage, Nick Cage, and I guess I felt that, you know, Cage would be a good name for the press to get a hold of. You know, here he comes, and he's busting out of his cage.
You never at any point thought, uh-oh, your friends are laughing. You never thought at any point, well, I kind of want people to know I'm related to Francis Ford, you know?
You know, I think people know that anyway, and it's, you know, I think that I just, you know, I guess I would go into casting offices, and what would happen is I would talk about Francis, who you know, he's a great guy, I love him, he's a very affectionate man, but I just didn't really want to talk about the 20 years that he had accomplished. And sometimes it would get in the way of the audition. And when I changed my name to Cage and I went up for, I guess it was Valley Girl, that was the first movie, and I got it the first time, so I knew I'd really done the right thing.
Yeah.
I didn't know you spoke Japanese, too.
No, I do. I do not. No, I do not speak Japanese. I was really put on the spot. Francis, I had studied Japanese for 1 year when I was about 15, and so it became this big deal in the family that I could speak Japanese. And I was up at the house once, and Francis had these very prominent Japanese investors there. They had the suit. They looked really pretty intense. And, of course, Francis put me on the spot and said, well, this is my nephew, Nicholas. He speaks Japanese. Can you say something to them? And I was just going like this, and they said, konbanwa to me, which it means good evening. And I looked at him, and I was like, yasai. And he says, oh, that's really interesting. You know, most people say hello, good evening, but this is the first time anyone's ever said vegetable.
What was your first film?
You know, I did this movie called Fast Times at Ridgemont High.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, they're clapping for the film.
I know. Because I'm hardly in the movie. I was still Nicholas Coppola then. And if you look at the movie carefully, you can see me behind a hamburger stand. I'm flipping hamburgers. There it is. I got my first close-up flipping hamburgers. That was my debut.
That was Sean's first big movie, right?
Sean, yeah, yeah, it was, definitely.
Yeah.
He was great in it.
Yeah, yeah, he's a cool guy. There seems to be a theme in movies of yours lately, Elvis in some form. Ah, is he here? It's a guy from Cleveland again. Shut your ass up.
he's totally eclipsing my career.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know. I don't know what I'm supposed to. You know, he's left the building and he's entered my life, and I don't know what I'm supposed to do about it.
Are you a big fan?
What am I to assume that I'm the highest paid Elvis impersonator? I mean, what is it? What is that? You know.
The Elvis stuff in this movie is really funny.
Oh yeah, it is. It's very funny. Yeah, I mean, that was great stuff. Andy Bergman, when he came up with that, he said he wanted to have it that I was with Siegfried and Roy on the airplane with a bunch of white tigers on the way. But then he changed it to the skydiving Elvises, which I think is great. But he's got this wonderful imagination.
Yeah. So you didn't come up with that. He didn't do it for you.
No, what?
I mean, put Elvis in there because he knows you.
Oh no. That was his idea totally. Wild at Heart was the movie where I did more of an Elvis thing. Mm-hmm. Honeymoon in Vegas, although Elvis's presence is in the movie, it was more of a sight gag with the costume. But, yeah.
We couldn't have gotten to the ending, though, without it. I mean, it's real important to this movie.
The Elvis.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it's a great, it's a wonderful climax.
Yeah.
It's terrific.
Yeah. Now, tattoos. I got to ask you about tattoos.
Tattoos?
Any new ones?
No. No new tattoos. No. I'm not talking about tattoos. Oh, no. Oh. I'm off of tattoos. No more tattoos.
Okay.
Because,
you know, you have a reputation for being a wild guy. And along with changing to a little more comedy as an actor, your personal life seems to be changing. You seem to be settling.
I don't know what makes you say that. I mean, I can still do this anytime I want, you know?
Warn me before you do that next time. I've seen all your movies, and when Nicolas Cage does that, it scares the out of you. You need to warn him, man, before you do that there.
No, you know, I started acting when I was 17, and I had all this sort of rebellious energy, and my heroes then were people like Pete Townsend, and they were smashing their guitars, and I grew up. I mean, I grew out of it. It's like, I guess you can say in some ways I have mellowed. It's very hard to take the character home with you. You know what I'm saying? The wild image is one thing, but I'm another.
Yeah. What was the last non-show business job you had before acting?
Well, I used to work at the Fairfax Movie Theater.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, down on Fairfax. I used to sell tickets and popcorn. I would try to figure out how to get from the concession stand to the screen. And that was what I would do. Just, how am I going to do that? How can I find that? How can I make that happen?
You made it happen, man.
Thanks, man.
And there's no better way to end this interview other than right there.
Okay.
Sarah Jessica Parker's in this movie. James is very good, very convincing. He makes you hate him in the end.
Yeah, he's wonderful in the movie. That was a hard character to pull off.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Go check it out. This is Nicolas Cage.
Everybody smile. Sit straight.
my next guest.
Shut up, man, we're doing a show.
Yo, Cineo. My next guests really know what it's like to be on top. For the past 5 weeks, they've had the number one song in the country. Performing End of the Road from the soundtrack of Boomerang. This is Boys to Men.
We belong together. And you know that I'm right. Oh, yeah. Why do you play with my heart? Why do you play with my mind? Should we be forever? Said it never died. How could you love me and leave me and never say goodbye? When I can't sleep at night without holding you tight, girl, each time I try, I just break down and cry. Pain in my head, oh, I'd rather be dead.
We're back, Boys to Men. Let's see, first introduce yourselves.
Hello, everybody. My name is Sean Slim Stockman.
My name is Nathan Alex Vanderpool Morris.
My name is Michael Bass McCary.
My name is Wanye Squirt Morris.
Yeah. I mentioned that the song is on the Boomerang soundtrack, but it's also on this album or CD.
Sales.
Yeah, yeah, and knowing Michael Bivens, he'll probably had a song on the Elton John album too.
No, that's right.
He's a good manager, good businessman.
Yeah, very good, very good.
Yeah, how do you guys feel?
Good.
Good. Very good.
Yeah. Very good.
Very good. This is our first number one single since our career, and we're very excited about it. You know, and we didn't expect for it to be as successful as it is right now. Mm-hmm. 5 weeks on the charts, right? Number one.
Yep. This week.
Thanks to everybody out there who requested it and supported Boyz II Men. That's why it's possible, and we thank you.
You ever think about quitting in the early days?
Yeah, there were times. Yeah. There were times when, you know, people were fed up and just wanted to quit the group because things were taking too long and just a whole bunch of emotional roller coasters.
Yeah. Yeah. We should talk about a serious subject for a minute. I'm going to mention Special K and turn it over to y'all, you know. I mean, from the early days when he entertained us and we had fun and the Mr. Telephone Man video, all the way down to keeping y'all straight on the road. He's gone now, and I'm sure it's a great loss to fans also. Tell them.
Well, the man he's talking about, his name is Mr. Khalil Roundtree, and he's the road manager for Boyz II Men, but he did a lot more than that. He was like a father, like a family member. I mean, Michael Bivens is the man that found Boyz II Men, but as far as seeing us on television and watching the way we act in public and different things like that, all of that is a tribute to Khalil Roundtree, and it was a great loss to all of us.
Yeah, this is a gentleman that also kind of brought new addition through the ranks as a guide, and I always remember him in the Mr. Telephone Man video when Bobby was little and
he didn't
little.
Like when you say that. Don't bring up the Mr. Telephone. Man.
We would always sing it.
Yeah. But may he rest in peace. We'll never forget him.
Oh yeah, definitely.
We will never forget him. Yes. You are such a class group of guys, and he deserves credit for keeping you all on the straight and narrow sometimes, you know?
Yeah, that's true.
That's very true.
We have Quatri.
He had to slap us in the head a couple of times. Definitely.
That's right.
Yeah,
literally.
He was the one. Yep.
And speaking of slapping in the head, if you don't say hello to your mother, she gonna slap you in the head, man.
Hi,
you always
Mom.
Forget.
Yeah, she was at the show the last time we were here, and she was kind of upset because I didn't acknowledge her. So, hi, Mom. I love you. Mwah.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm at a football game.
Huh?
I feel like we had a football game. Huh? Like when you don't hear the vocals, just
hello, Mom. We're number one. So, do you all get irritated when talk show hosts say, sing some a cappella?
No,
we kind of used to it.
That's how we started.
I'll just get out the way. Take us to commercial with anything you like to.
Dum-ba-dum.
They traveled over hills and mountains on a cold December night just like this. For they knew what was going to happen. Mary would give birth to the Prince of Peace, our Lord. From the manger what they saw in the distance was a misty silhouette of three kings, bringing all their most precious jewels to a savior, knowing he would soon be called the King of Kings, our Lord.
Come on, fellas.
On Christmas Day,
they saw a star in the eastern colonies. That marked the birthplace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
psych. Just like to mess with the audio man every now and then. My next guest recently finished 7 years as Christine Sullivan, the defense attorney on Night Court, and she has a new series called Hearts of Fire now with John Ritter. It premieres this Monday on CBS. Please welcome Markie. I am so, so fine. Post. They miss you. Do you miss your old Night Court friends?
You know, the first day I went to work on my new show, I had my Night Court keychain, my Night Court sweater, my Night Court shoes, my Night Court watch, my Night Court. Yeah, but I don't think I miss Night Court because I had a pretty good long time. But I miss the guys, you know. I do. I miss the guys.
Yeah.
Luckily, we're all friends. We will always be friends, you know, and that's neat. But I, you know what? It's kind of weird. When I left high school, which I loved high school, but I went to college, I just never looked back. I'm very fickle. I mean, it's kind of like, okay, on to the next thing. And that's sort of how I feel about this. I feel like I've sort of forgotten, you know, that I did Night Court for 7 years because I'm onto a new thing. I guess that's human nature.
Yeah, well, sometimes I avoid the painful feelings
That's true. What's that called? Yeah, avoidance, I guess.
Yeah, or something like that.
Yeah.
We'll ask Tony Grant to find out the official term. I want to ask you about the new show. It's called Hearts of Fire. Tell me what it's about.
Oh. Well, it's basically about men and women, in specific John Ritter and myself. Mm-hmm. You know, it's sort of an exploration by Linda Bloodworth Thomason, who is the finest writer in Hollywood, in my opinion.
Designing Women,
Evening Shade, and now Hearts of Fire, of the relationship between men and women. My character is a real bright, smart-mouthed journalist who's been all over the place, who's done, you know, won awards for her journalism, has been with Fidel Castro, has been with everybody, knows everybody. Everything is, you know, is her world is her oyster. But her father has now been jailed for embezzling money from the Teamsters, and so she spent her money and her reputation trying to get him out of jail. She's down on her luck, and she has to go kind of begging for a job as a press secretary at a senator's office, which is way beneath her. Mm-hmm. And John is his top aide. He's got 2 kids. His wife has left him for a lesbian lover. He's down on, you know, his life is just like...
Wow.
And it's a comedy. And it better be. And yeah. Anyway, so it's the two of us getting together and how I just like this person who's a chain smoker and puts cigarettes out in people's plates, dinner plates, and just keep talking, you know. I'm just completely oblivious to other people's feelings in the beginning. Obviously, it can't go on like that. And if you notice that I'm smoking in the pilot, I want everybody out there to know that they are herbal cigarettes and they don't have any tar or nicotine in them. I do quit in the next episode, so.
Herbal cigarettes?
Yeah. They smell like cabbage. Really horrible.
And Linda wanted the character to smoke?
Oh, yeah, because it was, you know, I think smoking is a real stupid thing to do. I mean, because we all know it can kill you, so it's a stupid thing to do. People do it anyway.
Yeah.
And this was a woman who just sort of not politically correct at all. She just flies in the face of everything, eats junk food, smokes cigarettes, you know, does all that, even knowing that it's a stupid thing to do. And eventually John, you know, can't take it anymore, and, you know, I end up quitting because I know I shouldn't do it. Yeah. But you know, you find people at the lowest points of their lives, they're going to do things that aren't, you know.
You know what?
Right.
Jerry Seinfeld has a funny bit about cigarette smoking and how it can be used as body language or punctuation in conversation.
True. Oh,
do you use
true.
It like
Is it
that?
Fun to act with? Yeah, I would blow smoke in his face at any given point. Just go. There was a one point where I say, you know, I tell him my whole life story and how I'm down. I mean, like I say, look, I really would appreciate it if you wouldn't tell anybody all this, because I got a lot of rich and influential friends in this town, and I really don't want them to know, but that wouldn't be telling you except for the fact that you're nobody. And I flick a cigarette out the window, and he's just standing there going, well, thanks. Thanks a lot.
The timing is with the cigarette. Yeah,
that's cool.
We got a clip, so we should look at that.
Oh, goody, oh, goody.
Hi. Hi, Mom. What's in this clip?
Well, I'm having to tell him now sort of my life story. I'm trying to keep up when I'm applying for the job, I'm trying to keep up my image and tell him, oh, I've been a liaison in Paris and I've done this and I've done that. After this scene, I kind of break down and tell the truth about myself. But you'll see, this is me auditioning for a job with John Ritter in a senator's office in Hearts of Fire.
Okay, CBS. What have you been doing for the last 6 months?
I served as cultural liaison in Paris.
Doing what?
Doing my job.
Which was?
I told you, being cultural liaison.
I don't know what that means.
If you must know, I worked at Euro Disney.
Doing what?
Helping people.
Helping people what?
Helping people on and off the teacup ride. Is that all right with you? Are you happy now? Oh, good. That got a laugh. Yeah. But John Ritter is hot. You will never have seen John Ritter like this. He is really hot.
Okay.
And he's wonderful. He's neat.
Once again, Hearts of Fire premieres Monday, September 14th on CBS, 8 o'clock to 9 o'clock, so it's an hour that
night. Just that night is an hour, and then it's 8:30 is its normal time slot, right after Evening Shade.
Okay. Just very quickly, give me 30 seconds, Marla. We're just about sick of politics in America right now, I'm sure, but you're the first person to tell me about Bill Clinton. I remember you told me all about
him. Yes, and then you had him on the show, and I thought that was so wonderful because people got to see Bill Clinton in a whole nother light. Wasn't that wonderful? They got to see this person, and I just love that you did that. And he had such a great time, and I began reading him reviews of his saxophone playing, and he loved that. He loved that he got some fairly okay reviews of his saxophone playing. Yeah. I mean, that was really meant a lot to him, but he also got to be seen as a person, which people hadn't really seen before. I thought that was wonderful.
He's cool. He's just a regular guy, which is what I liked about him. But let's talk about one of the other regular guys in the election, Dan Quayle. Do you think that the...
No.
Do you think that the... And I got to do this real quick. Do you think that the Emmy bashing of Dan Quayle was a little excessive or in poor taste?
Oh, I think it was incredibly excessive. And I also think that I wish that the community, the television community, had taken the high road. I really wish that, you know, I can't imagine any other thing. Let's say the Oscars had decided that they want to bash some Democratic icon, Hillary, for instance, and went on and on and on. Would we have stood for that for one second? The problem is we have polarized ourselves to the degree that if you don't agree with somebody, it's not just that you don't agree with them, it's that you hate them and they're evil, and that's just killing us. I really think that's killing us, and I think we didn't do ourselves a service at the Emmy, and I'm sorry it happened.
We'll be right back with Marky Pez.
Stay tuned as Dom DeLuise hosts Candid Camera. It's hilarious, and it's coming your way next here on TV 44.